You will be endlessly curious about the characteristics, disposition, abilities of the one we refer to as the lover, which is completely healthy. It would be less than natural if he weren't. Well, he can be anything, with the exception of being a killer. To understand why that's such a no-no for life, we need to think about the circumstance of endlessness in terms of space and distance. Quick link. With so much life all about us, we can't go anywhere pretty well without bumping into somebody. That's because we live in a finite, within a finite environment of the Earth. It's a completely, totally different circumstance once we enter the heavenly state. In the heavenly state, it is an endless void that is occupied only by living beings, ourselves. When we evolve into a form that reality can accommodate, in accordance with its own characteristic, that is, it's a most simplistic reality that can't sustain endlessly a flat reality. In that flat reality, there can only be a sustained motion, can only be sustained if it's of, if it complies, no, not if it is of the basic characteristic or format, natural condition of that reality. Because it is endless, in the true meaning of the word, it would be naive to compare our current situation with that state. And this is tied in, or tied to, the reason why life, every single life, is so precious. It's just a matter of trying to appreciate or imagine a situation where if the world was a million times bigger and there were only half a dozen people in it, how empty most of it would seem. Well, that's not even a good comparison, because an Earth that was a million times bigger than this, with just a half a dozen people, is still a crowded environment compared to the heavenly state. Think about that. Comparative reality, and you'll come to become acquainted with why all who experience the heavenly state couldn't bring themselves to lose or not have as many within it as there currently are. Getting back to his character, in those thunderously isolated conditions through which life came to be, it further highlights why company is so sought after. These points are being mentioned because there are those amongst us, and not to be considered unusual, who don't understand why the lover can, while things are as bad as they are, express the playful nature of his character. I'm not sure how well the writing it expresses or conveys his love of fun of life. But it is understood by serious-minded people that serious-minded people don't really feel that there is much playfulness to be acted out in our present situation. Our degree of dissatisfaction and suffering seems, well, is subjectively. A dishearteningly unappreciable, dishearteningly and unappreciable state from which to try and imagine playfulness and fun. As this screencast is being composed, the lover, God, is his thought, is suffering in a way that you and I couldn't. We don't have the basic, our projection, our entrance into existence starts at a cellular or multicellular level at the moment. The lover is in a subcellular state, interacting with devolving beings. Within 5,000 million years, the things he's experiencing now would have become the past. And within the next 5,000 million years, all those people who have managed to orient themselves to life within that time frame will be free of the experiences that our current society contains. So not only has God had to go through the unimaginable transition from an ultimate, sophisticated, evolved being with a nervous system that is as yet to be comprehended, through to a basic state of reality that exists, that is the basis of the Big Bang. So he's gone from the ultimately refined conscious entity just prior to the Big Bang to the basic state that consciousness can experience. But then there was about 13,000 million years, no less than that, Mines. About 9,000 million years to the stage when the first cells were began the process of creating what we refer to as the ecosystem. And then a further 10,000 million years to where he emerges as a man-shaped being. When he will be one of us, sharing the environment we've created between now and then. From his point of view, the worst has happened. It's always from our point of view, it will be the case when we are in his company that the bad aspects that had to be experienced mainly by him will be a thing of the past. This monologue, which you're listening to, is being gone into in order to try and assuage the outlook that doesn't feel as though the idea of a fun-loving, playful environment is anywhere near where we are. Well, that's true, but it should also be remembered or taken into account that it's going to be like that from God's point of view for the next few thousand million years. I mean, it doesn't end when our civilization gets to the stage where we've rid ourselves of unnatural death. Put in a link there for the word assuaged. What we consider to be acceptable or ideal or satisfactory as a lifestyle isn't so from God's point of view. And the refining of that outlook has yet to take a lot more forms and at this moment they will seem, were they to be presented as goals that were to be incorporated now, it would just become a seemingly hopeless task. So the lover, the cherub, in this instance, in a childish form can express his playfulness and fun-loving nature, even though things are as bad as they are from our point of view. The trick is for you and I to realize, to take into our perception, the way we think about the way life is, our perception of life as it is at the moment, to see it as being acceptable from the point of view of those who are living within expansive, within an expansive lifestyle, with those who are doing the opposite. We need to be able to be happy and playful whilst we're addressing these problems. It would be an imbalance to be just happy with no regard to the problems we have. In the same way, it would be an imbalance to be too solemn . It's knowing where to draw the line, isn't it? Where to strike that balance. Expressing humour and happiness whilst being aware or mindful that there are people who are trying to destroy that happiness. Well, it would appear, it seems, at the moment, that the best way to do that is to associate oneself with only those people who do understand the long-term goals that we're trying to achieve and are able to demonstrate their preparedness to achieve those goals by living within ethical parameters. There is a difficulty, and this is being encountered on a regular basis, that there are people who genuinely want and are prepared to do so much to achieve what's being offered, which life is offering, and feel as though they can do that and justify doing it outside of ethical parameters. And this is a problem that has been with this website right from the beginning. As soon as it was as it was realised, just how precious life was and how easy it was to bring about the death of a child, and the ways that's done in ordinary day-to-day living, trying to keep that happy disposition and at the same time express or explain to people how precarious that's the meaning that's being, the word precarious is being used to that's the context of the meaning of the word that was just used. How precarious the situation is. And when the actual details of the lifestyle that doesn't contain murder is explained, people, I don't know what they think, but it's difficult for people to think that they're part of the future. The way that they're not part of the future, the way they are. And how can you be happy? And that phrase has been used a few times when this point has been brought up. People say, well, I can't be happy unless I'm doing this, that or the other, which contains death outcome realities. So this person is of the outlook, the mental disposition, has the mental disposition that includes or incorporates the feeling that if a person knows that they're doing the right thing, then there's no reason why they can't be happy and playful and funful. I don't know if that's a word. Well, it is now. While they're living that lifestyle. So the way that it is coped with is not to bring it up. Providing it isn't brought up in conversation or it isn't pointed out immediately, you meet somebody that you think what they're doing is wrong and get their back up, it's easier not to mention it. But that only goes so far, of course. I mean, while we've got the oligarchs and the third party causing worldwide mayhem, I mean, you know, when you're not happy, it's down to these guys. Not down to a person who says, well, just a moment, my mate, you're off beat here with that outlook or with that bit of lifestyle. That's where it comes down to, that particular frame of mind. The way this person's had to cope with that dilemma is not to try and, oh, that's the meaning of the word as it was just used, is not to associate with people who are out of ethical parameters at all, which has limited the lifestyle almost made it almost unlivable. So the whole point here is that what we think of as being proper and socially acceptable here and now is a individualistic, it is seen by each individual in a slightly different way, and the variation or the scope of that outlook extends from being happy while you're in war killing people, as is the state in a few places now, to only mixing with people who are rigidly living within ethical parameters and are happy doing so. But I think you've got the point. I think the point's been covered. So we'll wind up by saying that the lover can present the fun side of his character because he does everything completely right, and he's sharing that fun-loving, playful nature with somebody who can appreciate how it is valid in this place and time.